So hello everyone, I'm Xavier Gant, software engineer at Algolia, and I will speak about testing in production, and especially how to do it without compromising availability. And now it should be good, or not. Bon, so let's do without that. So first, what is Algolia? So Algolia is a search API. We are available in 16 regions, and in those 16 regions, we have 55 data centers to be able to provide the best availability possible. This infrastructure is able to answer more than 13 billion queries per month, and we now have more than 4,500 customers. So the agenda of today is pretty simple. So first, we'll speak about why do you want to do that, then how to do that properly, and finally, how do you do that at Algolia? So let's start with why you want to do that and why you don't want to test everything, which is simpler. And not at the end, because just of the complexity. At Algolia, we have more than 20 search parameters to configure the ranking. So if they were only Booleans, it's already a million tests to write, to test all the possible combinations. And so it will be like really hard to implement all of them. And so it will make your implementation slower just to write the test. Then once you are happy, you wrote them, just to run them, it's again a pain. So your implementation will be again slower just to validate your changes. And a code, it's a test, it's still a code, so you have to maintain it. If you want to refactor something, you will also end up refactoring the test. And finally, something that is nearly possible to do, it's to test the performance. Because you may optimize one request, but it will maybe load more your database. And so at the end, the average of response time will be higher just because of that. So you need to test on real production environment. And so to do that, you would need to duplicate your infrastructure. Then why you don't do everything in production? Because you want to make your customers happy, and so you can't. And so the good compromise is to do both at the same time. So the goal of the test are there to avoid to do the mistakes twice, because during the implementation phase, your customer will be happy to help you to improve your product. But once they are in production, they don't expect those issues to come up again. And also, the tests are a really good thing to validate a new implementation or a change. So you still need them. And when you are a new contributor on a big project, it's always good to have tests, because as the main contributor, it's easy to remember, OK, this function does that. Here is the preconditions for this function. I know how it works. For a newcomer, the only source of truth is the tests are passing or not. So you still need to have a good coverage. And on the other side, you will leverage the test in production to discover the edge cases, because okay, you don't test the 1 million possibilities, but you will still discover them in production. So that's why you want that. And also, that's where you will really be able to validate your performance optimization. So once we know why we want to do that, now how to do that properly, because testing in production is risky, and you want to keep your service available. So the first thing is that the software design, and the first thing to do is to don't trust anything, because everything can break. So if, for example, you rely on other services, maybe they are also testing in production, so they can fail too. Or they can return corrupted data. If you expect a valid JSON, it will maybe end up broken. And so if your application doesn't handle it, then it can pop up until the end user. And that's not what you expect. Then inside the code, if, for example, for a procedure you expect preconditions, or a function expect, for example, an integer greater than zero, you should test it inside the function, because maybe somebody else will use your function and use it with the wrong parameters. So it's always good to have those preconditions tested. And if they fail, the best is also to have a detailed error, so to log something, because the worst thing in production is to have something broken and don't know at all why it's broken. And finally, to test performance and usage, it's good to like let your software produce metrics and so on, so then you will be able to exploit them after. Because you can guess that a change will improve performance. If you don't measure it, it's not a really good thing. Then, once you have the software ready, you need to have the infra to be able to test in production. So the first thing to do is to have at least two instances, one to run like the stable code, and the other one to test the new code that may break. And even if you have two instances, it's still good to have backups, because for example, if you have two front-end instances and they rely on the same database, if the new code corrupts your database or like delete it, okay, the other one will still be impacted. So backups are also something to consider when you test in production. On the other side, if you have a broken instance and your users are still using it, they will still see the issue. So what you want is to have either a smart client, so at the JavaScript level, or a smart backend at the load balancer level, to retry on the instance that is able to answer your request. And so at that stage also, you need to handle like invalid answers. So it's not because your program answers that it's a valid one. And finally, once you have that, if you have a smart backend and you deploy something that is broken, you may not notice it, because the load balancer will catch it for you. And so if you don't know that one of the instances is broken, you will end up with an issue when you will deploy on the second one. And a good thing to do is to like push the alert and not pull it, because if, for example, you deploy a broken code but it breaks only after 5 or 10 minutes, and you check in the first like 5 minutes, you won't notice that you broke something. And so it needs to be pushed. So once you have the software and the infrastructure ready, the last thing to do is to think about how do you want to deploy. And if, for example, you have multiple environments, because, for example, you have one infrastructure for the internal development, one for staging, and one for production, you can limit the impact on your production by first deploying and testing. Let your internal developers try it and break it. Then, if it's fine, move it to staging. Let somebody else try to break it. And so it should be caught at the first or second step. And finally, when it's in production, you are pretty confident that it won't break. And so with that, you have a progressive deployment, because usually you will have few testing machines, a bit more staging, and a lot of production machines. The second thing to consider is to always deploy something that you can roll back, because if, for example, you deploy something and you need 7 hours, a day or two to fix, then it means that your service will be broken during this period of time. While if you can roll back, you will just roll back on the previous version, take enough time to fix it properly, and then push it to production. Because a thing that you can do when you can't roll back is to push a quick fix that is even worse, and so just push the issue further. And as I explained before, for the logging, it's if you need to roll back, it's also good to know why you need to roll back, because you will have to fix your issue. So if you roll back and you have to deploy again to see, ah, the issue is actually there, so now I can fix it, okay, you lost. So the best is to have like logs to know why it fails and to debug quickly. Then if your application is producing metrics and your monitoring is testing your API, you have multiple sources of information. So if the monitoring is broken, the metrics produced will be a second source of information. So it's better to have multiple of them to be able to assess how your software works. And finally, if you can leverage that to automatically roll back, it will be faster than any human, because the software will be able to roll back in few seconds with the health check, while just typing the command will be more than a few seconds. So that's how we to do that. Now, how we do that here. So as I said, we are a search API, and every time you subscribe to Algolia, you have access to a cluster of three nodes. Each node of the cluster can answer independently to read operations. So even if you have two nodes which are broken, the third one will still answer your request. Then we decided to move the retry strategy at the client level, because since our cluster are spread across multiple data centers, we didn't want to add response latency when you try on another machine. For our database, since we are a search engine, we have indices, and those indices are a custom binary format, which is totally homemade. And when we have like diff, for example, a customer updates a product, we don't spread inside the cluster the process data, we spread the diff, so that if one node corrupts the index, it won't spread to the others. And then inside the code, we have multiple checks triggering alerts, so that when there is an issue, we know it directly after the deployment. And in the worst case where the program crashed, we will have a core dump to have the complete stack of where it crashed, and we'll be able to dig inside. Then for the monitoring, we have three sources of informations. The first one is the ping probes. So the goal of the ping probes is to check if this machine is available and if you are able to perform a read operation on it. The second one is the indexing operation. The role of this one is to check if you are able to send new data and replicate it inside the cluster. And the third one are like time series metrics, so like search capacity, number of incoming requests, or incoming indexing operations. And so based on all those informations, we trigger alert if it goes above a certain limit. So then when you deploy in few minutes, you are aware of if something is broken. And so the last thing is the deployment. To be sure that we don't, be able to track all the bug fixes and so on, we only have two versions running at the same time. We have more than 1,500 servers. So it was really a good thing to have only two versions, because you can quickly end up with five of them. And then when you have an alert, to remember which one fixed the issue starts to be a pain. So that's why you have only two versions, the previously deployed and the one currently in deployment. And we release on those servers every week to keep the changes small, because the biggest the changes are, the hardest is it to find which one triggered the bug. Then for the rollback, we always make the changes backward compatible. So that we don't have to go through migration processes where you, like, if you stop in the middle, you are screwed, because you can't either go back on the previous version or move to the next one. And since we have a a binary format, we also need to handle like changes inside this binary format. And so for that, we always go with like two-step deployment, where first we deploy the capability to read the new format, and then we deploy the capability to write it. So in that case, we can roll back at any step, and we are still able to read the indices. And finally, for the procedure, we have an automatic rollback. So few seconds after the deployment, we will perform all the health check to see that the API is running, that it's able to index, and so on. And then for the procedure, I will explain it a bit more in detail. So first, we divided our infra in 10 different groups. So we have first all the testing machines. Then we have staging, self-serve, and enterprise. And we divided those last three groups in three subgroups, to where each group is one of the node inside the cluster. And so then, how do we deploy on those 10 groups? So first, we'll deploy on testing. So testing, we don't have any critical data. If we corrupt data, if we lose data, it's not an issue. It's only used internally with temporary indices. So we don't care to lose data there. Then we deploy on staging, but only on one machine. Because here on staging, we have data that we want to keep. And it's used still internally, but we don't want to lose the data. So we first deploy on the first machine, then we deploy on self-serve. And why we deploy on self-serve instead of enterprise? It's not because they pay less than enterprise. It's because on one self-serve cluster, we have more than 1,000 customers. So deploying on one cluster of our self-serve will test the same than deploying on 1,000 servers of enterprise. So that's why we do that. And also because if you deploy on one machine, we can easily fix this machine if we have an issue, while if you have 1,000 machines to fix manually, you won't be able to make it before a couple of days. So that's why we deploy on self-serve and then on enterprise to finally test all the use cases. And once the deployment is done on the three first machine, we'll do that on the second nodes and then on the third nodes. And so with that, if you have an issue and it happens only few hours or days, you will catch it on the first nodes before the last one is actually corrupted. So to sum up about that, testing in production is something that you can do at any scale, because you can start with a blue-green deployment with only two instances and a load balancer in front. When you start by doing that at the beginning, you will design your software in a way that it's resilient, and you will take technical choices that you wouldn't without. And it's exactly the same for your infra. Since we started to like do that at the beginning, our infra is pretty resilient. And the only place where we failed was mainly on the how to deploy progressively. And the good thing also, it makes the implementation phase faster, because you write the test to test 90% of the case. Then you test all the features used in production, and so you are able to iterate quickly with that, because you are never afraid to break something, because the infrastructure is resilient enough to handle it for you. And so that's it. Do you have questions? Yes. Could you speak in the catch box so then it's recorded?
Okay. So how many times do we deploy per day, per week, per?
So it's we deploy on all the infra once a week. Okay. And usually to be sure that we keep enough time to let the bug triggers, we leave one day between each deployment on the first, second, and third node.
Okay, and how do you deal with diffs between deployments? For instance, if you have if you deploy on Monday, for instance, mm-hmm. and the next week you want to deploy another thing, but you just realize that there's a bug. How do you deal with diffs between nodes? If one node or one stack of nodes
yes.
have a version of your code. How do you deal with a new version that's coming up and
so
an old one that's bugged?
So if there is a bug in a version, so we have two ways to handle it. Either we are able to fix it for the next deployment, or either we revert this one and move forward with the next changes.
Okay.
We never keep a bug in production for a long period of time.
All right. And I have another question.
Mm-hmm.
How do you deal with different pieces of code that are dependent between your front-end and your back-end? For instance, if your front-end depends on a new version of your back-end, but your backend isn't already deployed yet. How do you deal with that?
So for that, usually the backend is deployed way before the frontend.
Okay.
So the feature will be ready in the backend, and then we'll test it with the new frontend.
Which means that your backend must maintain both versions of the code for the frontends.
I got your question. So we never change the API. We always keep the same API because we don't want to ask our like 4,000 customers to change their code, because if you do that, you will wait years to have the update of all the customers. So we always do like incremental changes. We don't modify the existing ones.
And when you have to do so, there must be a system of, I don't know, deprecation or something like that.
So we never did that. We thought about ways to version the API, but considering how it would be painful for our customers, we didn't make enough mistake in the API yet to want to like version it.
Questions?
No.
Okay.
Okay. Thank you.